Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Read Daniel by Tremper Longman III. Narrated by David Cochran Heath. Introduction. Invitation to the Book of Daniel. The fiery furnace, the writing on the wall, the lion's den. These are among the most memorable moments in the first six chapters of the Book of Daniel. Four monstrous beasts rising from a chaotic sea, one like a son of man, 77s, kings of the north and kings from the south, the righteous rising like the stars forever and ever. These are among the most striking descriptions of the second six chapters of the Book of Daniel. In the first six chapters, we read stirring stories of Daniel and the four friends' faith in the midst of a hostile and dangerous culture. In the second six chapters, we read about Daniel's disturbing yet ultimately encouraging visions of the future. What are we to make of it all? What does it all mean, and does the book speak to us today? These are the questions that motivate the writing of this book, and as we answer them, we will hear that the author of the Book of Daniel not only spoke loud and clear to his generation, but also to ours. In spite of present circumstances, God is in control, and He will have the final victory. We will explore this fascinating but ancient book in three parts in order to come to grips with how to read it in the 21st century. In the first part, we will focus on overarching issues that influence our understanding of the message of the book to its original audience and set up how we should then appropriate it today. Part 1 deals with literary issues, genre, language, and structure, Chapter 1, historical setting, both for the background of the book and the date of its final composition, Chapter 2, and its main theological message, Chapter 3. In Part 2, we will go over the contents of the book with an emphasis on its meaning for the original audience. We start by examining the six stories of Daniel and his three friends in a foreign court, found in Daniel chapters 1 through 6. First, we will discuss the tales of court contest found in Daniel chapters 1, 2, 4, and 5. Chapters 4 through 7, and then at the tales of court conflict found in Daniel chapters 3 and 6, chapters 8 and 9. After covering the stories of the first six chapters of Daniel, we move on to a close analysis of the four apocalyptic visions found in Daniel chapter 7 verse 1 through chapter 12 verse 4, chapters 10 through 13. Last, we will briefly listen to the final instructions given to Daniel. Daniel chapter 12, verses 5 through 13, after all his experiences in the court and in the spiritual realm. Chapter 14. Finally, part 3 views the message of Daniel from the perspective of the 21st century. In particular, we explore how the first six chapters help us live a faithful life in the midst of a culture toxic or even hostile to our faith. Chapter 15. And the latter six chapters provide us comfort and hope as we live in a difficult and often dangerous world, Chapter 16. Part 1. Reading Daniel in its original setting. This book, like its predecessors in the How to Read series, is not a commentary. While it includes commentary, the purpose is to orient the listener to a proper reading of the Book of Daniel. Thus, we are interested in questions of interpretive method and its application. Accordingly, Part 1 represents an overview of the book from a literary, historical, and theological perspective. In the three chapters that follow, we examine the genre, structure, style, and language of Daniel, Chapter 1, as well as the historical background, Chapter 2, and the major theological message of the book, Chapter 3. 1. Stories and visions in the midst of oppression. Genre, language, and structure. The Book of Daniel has a most curious structure. The first six chapters tell six different, though related, stories. They present four noble Judean young men, Daniel and his three friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, as political hostages in a foreign court. The six separate stories, one in each chapter, are each set in either the Babylonian, Daniel chapters 1 through 5, or Persian, Daniel chapter 6, courts. The four men are exiles, but they are also trained and take their place in the center of power. These stories, as we will hear, conform to ancient Near Eastern protocol but also serve as models for the behavior of God's people when they find themselves in situations of oppression. We will unpack these matters in later chapters, but for now, notice how these six chapters contrast in style and format with the last six chapters, Daniel chapters 7 through 12. The opening six stories in many ways are straightforward. We will hear that these narratives have relatively simple plots and clearly delineated characters. While interesting and profound, they are not complicated when studied closely in their ancient context. On the contrary, the second half of the book contains symbolic visions that, particularly to a modern audience, are mind-boggling and extremely difficult to understand. Hybrid beasts arise out of a chaotic sea. One like a son of man rides a cloud into the presence of the Ancient of Days. A ram and a goat butt each other. An angel speaks about 70 weeks of years. The final vision presents the future in terms of alternating kings of the north and kings of the south. Many modern readers find the type of literature found in the last six chapters of the book very difficult to understand beyond the idea that the four visions, Daniel chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 9, and chapters 10 through 12, point to some disaster at the end. Christians who read Daniel chapters 7 through 12 are reminded of the book of Revelation, and often, like Revelation, find the message confusing as well as a bit frightening. Many choose to avoid the book. Of course, if we avoid the book or misunderstand it, then we will miss a critical part of God's message to us. And we will realize that the book, both parts, is not as difficult to understand as we might think at first glance, provided we read it on its own terms and in the context of its original culture. Genre: Court Tales, Daniel chapters 1 through 6. We begin with an introduction to the genres of the book. All six stories of these chapters are set in a court foreign to Daniel and his three friends. We learn in the first chapter, which serves as a kind of introduction to the rest of the stories, that Daniel and his three friends were forcibly relocated to Babylon, an empire that had successfully compelled the nation of Judah to assume vassal status in its rapidly expanding empire. As is typical to such scenarios in the ancient Near East, the sovereign nation makes the vassal nation send some people from its noble class to the heart of the empire for training, really indoctrination, and redeployment to serve the interests of the empire. We will say more about these matters next, but this opening explains the reason for the setting of these six chapters. At first, Daniel and his three friends, among the noble class of Judah so deported, find themselves in the Babylonian court of Nebuchadnezzar down through the end of the Babylonian Empire. But then, when the Persians defeat the Babylonians, they will serve in the Persian court. We refer to these six chapters as tales, but we do not intend to communicate the idea that they are pure fiction. They are not fairy tales. Many scholars today reject their historical reliability, but many other scholars, myself included, would disagree. We will discuss the historical truthfulness of the Book of Daniel later, chapter 2. But for now, I simply want to explain that I refer to them as tales, not because I believe they are made-up stories, but rather because they have a story-like character. Hans Frey, a well-respected Yale theologian of a generation ago, famously spoke of the narratives of the Old Testament as history-like stories. I think he got this exactly reversed, though his quote indicates that he rightly saw that there was a historical character to these narratives that also displayed a literary brilliance. I would capture the same reality by saying that much of the narrative in the Old Testament, including Daniel chapters 1 through 6, is story-like history. And so I think it is fair to use the term tale in respect to Daniel chapters 1 through 6, as long as we realize that such a term does not undermine the historical referentiality of these chapters. But what kind of tales are they? Because of their setting, scholarship appropriately calls them court tales. But they can be divided into two primary types: tales of court contest and tales of court conflict. A tale of court contest describes a scene in which a superior has a problem that needs to be solved, and he enlists his subordinates to help him resolve the problem, and then the subordinates engage in a type of competition to do so. The party that resolves the issue then receives an appropriate reward. This general plot summary describes Daniel chapters 1, 2, 4, and 5. though we will wait till later chapters to describe how their specific plots fit into this general pattern. We will hear how this type of tale highlights the vast superiority of the god of Daniel and his three friends over the false gods of the Babylonians. The two tales of court conflict that we have in Daniel chapters 3 and 6 achieve the same goal of promoting Yahweh over the false gods of the Babylonians. These chapters display the animosity that the Babylonian wise men had toward the Hebrew youths. By chapter 3, the latter have been promoted due to their success in the court contests, thanks to God. Now envy sets in as their Babylonian peers do their best to sabotage their careers and even their lives. Again, we will describe the specific plots when we come to later chapters. But we will hear how God intervenes to preserve the lives and promote the careers of the three friends, Daniel chapter 3, and Daniel, Daniel chapter 6. Apocalyptic visions, Daniel chapters 7 through 12. While the first six chapters are court tales, the last six are four visions that are rightly described as apocalyptic. The English term apocalyptic derives from a Greek term, apokalypsis, that appears in the opening verse of the book of Revelation, the apocalypse of Jesus Christ. Indeed, the word in Greek is often translated revelation and ends up giving the book its name in the English tradition. In many ways, to be discussed later, the book of Daniel is similar, of the same genre, as the book of Revelation, and both can be described as apocalyptic books. But what are the characteristics of apocalyptic literature? As we mentioned, the Greek term apokalypsis means revelation, and we begin there. Apocalyptic is a form of divine revelation given to human beings. But of course, there is more than one type of revelation in the Bible. The term apocalyptic describes the type of revelation that is found in Daniel and Revelation and some portions of the Old Testament that have some or all of the same characteristics as those two books, Isaiah chapters 24 through 27 and parts of Zechariah, as well as a number of extra-biblical books written in the intertestamental period through the time of the New Testament, 1 Enoch, 4 Ezra, and 2 Baruch, for example. What these biblical and extra-biblical books have in common will be described in the following paragraphs. The revelation of the future that we refer to as apocalyptic has certain features that we might compare and contrast to what might be called classical prophecy, which also contains revelations about the future. While the Bible has many examples of the latter, for instance, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and the 12 minor prophets, we will illustrate this comparison and contrast it by looking at the differences between Daniel and Jeremiah. First, we should note that the revelations that God gives Daniel and Jeremiah have different goals, and this difference leads to different tasks for the two men. God gives Jeremiah a vision of the future in order to encourage the people to whom he is speaking to repent and avoid that future. Jeremiah speaks to the people in his community to tell them that they have sinned by breaking the covenant with God through their idolatry and other behaviors, and so they will be punished according to the curses of the covenant. Among the curses are those that warned about defeat at the hand of an enemy and exile from the land. See, for example, Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 25 through 29. Thus, prophets like Jeremiah can be called covenant lawyers. God uses them to accuse the people of violations of the law and to threaten them with punishments drawn from the curses of the covenant unless they repent. See Deuteronomy chapters 27 and 28. For this reason, Jeremiah receives God's revelation, which he shares with the people in the hope that they repent. As it turns out, they don't repent. And so eventually God tells Jeremiah to change his tune and just announce the coming judgment. The point is that a prophet shares the revelation with the people. When we turn to Daniel in the apocalyptic portion of the book, the first thing we notice is that God never speaks to Daniel directly. Instead, Daniel has visions or dreams that disturb him. Eventually, an angelic interpreter, when given a name, Gabriel, comes and explains the vision or dream to him. Then, surprisingly at first, we notice that Daniel is never charged to share his revelation with the people. Indeed, at one point he is told to roll up and seal the words of the scroll until the time of the end. Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. These differences between Jeremiah and Daniel may be found in the purpose of the revelation given to them. Daniel does not speak to God's people with the hope of leading them to repent. Daniel's visions have the purpose of reassuring the people in the midst of their oppression and persecution that God has control of the situation and will ultimately bring judgment on their oppressors. Thus, while prophets are often the bearers of bad news for the people of God, "You have sinned, and you will be punished unless you repent," Daniel is the bearer of good news. "Though you are living under oppression, know that God is in control and will have the final victory." The book of Revelation, the other major example of apocalyptic literature in the Bible, has the same dynamic as the book of Daniel. But there are other features of content and style that differentiate revelation of the future given to prophets like Jeremiah from revelation of the future given to Daniel. The first has to do with the far-reaching nature of their respective interest in the future. Since prophets are interested in an immediate response of repentance, they typically speak about relatively near-term possibilities. While this does not mean that some of their oracles do not have longer-term ramifications, they usually speak of things that will happen near-term. For instance, many modern readers of Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel." We'll see that it has a clear near-term fulfillment. After all, in context, Isaiah is speaking to King Ahaz, who is worried about a threat from two kings, Pekah of the northern kingdom and Rezin of Aram, Syria. Isaiah is telling him that he should not worry and either cave to their demands or ally himself with Assyria, which he eventually does because God will take care of him. The birth of the child to the virgin, or young woman, is a sign that will indicate to Ahaz that God is indeed speaking through Isaiah. Therefore, it is something that will happen relatively soon, since by the time his son will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. Isaiah chapter 7, verses 15 and 16. The text couldn't be more obvious that even this famous verse, while having an intensified fulfillment in the birth of Jesus, found its original fulfillment in the years right after it was uttered. On the other hand, apocalyptic literature, such as Daniel and Revelation, has its ultimate sights not on the near-term future, but on the far-distant future, indeed, the end of time. After all, the focus is on God's ultimate and everlasting victory. This does not mean that Daniel and Revelation don't speak about present realities or even more short-term future realities, but these are in the service of talking about God's great victory at the end. We can see another difference, at least in degree, in the type of language we find in apocalyptic and prophetic literature. Apocalyptic literature describes the future in highly figurative language. Now, don't get me wrong, vivid imagery fills the pages of Scripture. Genesis depicts the creation of the first human being as a result of God, who is a spirit, forming him from dust and breathing into his nostrils. Samson snaps the bowstrings with which Delilah bound him as easily as a piece of string snaps when it comes close to a flame. Judges chapter 16, verse 9. The poetic portions of the Old Testament bombard the reader with metaphors and similes. In the book of Psalms, God is described as a king, Psalm 47. A shepherd, Psalm 23, a warrior, Psalm 7, a mother of a weaned child, Psalm 131, a drunk soldier, Psalm 78, verse 65, and on and on. Prophets like Jeremiah use imagery as well to communicate their message. In an oracle in Jeremiah chapter 24, God describes his people to Jeremiah as two baskets of figs. The good figs are the exiles, but the bad figs are people like King Zedekiah, his officials, and those who are still living in the land of Judah, and those who escaped to Egypt. While virtually every chapter of the Old Testament contains figurative language of one sort or another, apocalyptic literature, Daniel, Revelation, and extra-biblical apocalyptic sources, has a certain distinctive and strikingly pervasive use of figurative language. Daniel chapter 7 speaks of monstrous beasts rising out of a turbulent sea. Daniel chapter 8 pictures two warring nations as a goat with a large horn butting a ram that had two horns. Daniel chapter 9 turns the 70 years of the exile announced by Jeremiah into 70 sevens in what is one of many examples of the figurative use of numbers in Daniel and in apocalyptic literature generally. Daniel 10 describes a celestial figure, dressed in linen, with a belt of fine gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like topaz, his face like lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and his voice like the sound of a multitude. Daniel chapter 10, verses 5 and 6. Daniel chapter 12 describes the wise, who we will later see are the likely audience of the book of Daniel, as those who will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness, like the stars forever and ever. Daniel chapter 12, verse 3. The imagery strikes modern readers as bizarre and obscure. We will explore the meaning of these and the other images later in this book, but for now we should note that the characteristic imagery of apocalyptic literature, while odd to us, was not odd to its ancient, original audience. We will see that much of it draws on well-known ancient Near Eastern mythology, the sea and its beasts representing chaos and evil, and previous biblical ideas, hybrid beasts as unclean and therefore repulsive. Many modern readers encounter these images and shake their heads, whereas an ancient audience would have instinctively known the significance of this language. Again, this reminds us how important it is to put ourselves in the place of the ancient reader as we interpret the books of the Old Testament. Further, apocalyptic literature paints the world, past, present, and future, in highly contrastive terms. Scholars often speak of apocalyptic literature's perspective as dualistic in terms of time, place, and ethics. The author thinks in terms of the present and the future, the earth and heaven, and evil and good. There are no gray areas. He describes the present earthly reality as evil as he gives hope that the future heavenly existence will be good. Finally, it is not hard to find those who describe apocalyptic literature as pessimistic. After all, the present is evil and the people of God are experiencing oppression and persecution, and the future is going to bring judgment and devastation. It all sounds very depressing. But then such an evaluation depends on what side of the divide one is on. For the oppressor, the news is bad. For the persecuted, the news is good. As we will hear throughout this book, Daniel has one overriding message that he is communicating to God's faithful, oppressed people, the wise, Daniel chapter 12, verse 3. In spite of present circumstances, God is in control. He will have the final victory. I submit that, rather than being pessimistic, apocalyptic literature is optimistic. God's people will be freed from their oppression, while those who harm them will be punished. Language and structure. We have already observed how the book of Daniel can be divided into two big parts. The first six chapters are six separate court tales, and the second six chapters are four apocalyptic visions. Such a division of the book seems like a neat division into two discrete and separate parts, but there are features that bind these two parts together. I have also already mentioned what is the most important feature that binds these two parts together: the central theme. Each of the six tales and four visions seeks to assure the reader that God is in control and will have the final victory. I will explain how these tales and visions propel this message when we come to part two of the present book. The second feature that connects these two parts of the book are the languages in which the chapters were written. Yes, that's right, languages. Almost all of the rest of the Old Testament, with the exception of a large part of the book of Ezra, chapter 4, verse 8 through chapter 6, verse 18, and chapter 7, verses 12 through 26, was written in Hebrew, but about half of Daniel was written in Aramaic. We might expect that the language divide would mirror the genre divide, but it doesn't, at least not perfectly. The book opens in Hebrew and continues in that language until we come to Daniel chapter 2, verse 4, where the narrator tells us that in response to a demand by King Nebuchadnezzar, the astrologers answered the king in Aramaic, and then the language shifts from Hebrew to Aramaic. The fact that the Babylonian astrologers would speak in Aramaic is not particularly surprising, since that was the everyday language of the Babylonian court. By that time, Aramaic was also the lingua franca, international language of diplomacy, finance, and politics of the day, so the Hebrew reader would be able to read it. By shifting to Aramaic, the text gains vividness and realism. What is surprising, though, is that the language of the text does not shift back to Hebrew after the Babylonian astrologers speak. Indeed, the book of Daniel continues to be written in Aramaic until the end of chapter 7, and then it shifts back to Hebrew from chapter 8 until the end of the book in chapter 12. Various theories have been given for why this language shift happens, but none of these theories have gotten much traction among a broader group of scholars. Fortunately, not knowing why does not affect our ability to read the book with understanding. The only reason why I am even bringing it up, besides the fact that it is an interesting fact, is that we should notice how the language change does not conform to the genre change, binding the two parts together. And this observation leads to another one that further solidifies the connection between the two parts, court tales and apocalyptic visions, and also offers a further insight into the structure of the book. The Aramaic portion of the book, chapters 2 through 7, incorporates five of the court tales and the first apocalyptic vision, which relate to each other by means of a characteristically Hebrew way called chiasm. Chiasm, as a structuring device, derives its name from the Greek letter chi, which is an X. Thus, the name indicates a structure that has a crossing pattern. This crossing pattern can be of different lengths and complexity, but typically highlights similarity between the first and last unit, then the second and second-to-last unit, the third and third-to-last unit, and potentially further. While this pattern occurs in Hebrew literature from the verse level to the book level, some biblical readers see chiasms all over the place when they are not there. That admitted, Daniel chapters 2 through 7 does appear to be in a chiastic relationship. The similarity between the paired chapters extends to the details of the plots or the similarity of the related dream and vision. The structure firmly connects the two parts of Daniel, tales and visions, so they should be read together even if they had different origins. It also highlights the introductory role of the first chapter. Daniel chapter 1 connects to Daniel chapters 8 through 12 by its language, Hebrew, but clearly serves as an introduction to the entire book. As we will hear, the chapter introduces the main protagonists, Daniel and his three friends, and explains how they came to Babylon. The plot of the chapter informs us about the deep faith of the four men who are living in a culture that is toxic to their faith. Thus, the chapter sets the reader up for the following court tales and provides the setting for the four visions. That said, we will hear that it does have a close connection with Daniel chapter 2 because it continues the story of how the successes of the four are not the result of their Babylonian training, but the result of God's grace. Summary. The book of Daniel contains six stories about Daniel in a foreign court, chapters 1 through 6, and four apocalyptic visions, chapters 7 through 12. In later chapters, we will dig into the contents of these stories and visions and see that, though there are interesting differences between them, they all have the same basic theme or message. In spite of present difficulties, God is in control, and He will have the final victory. In this chapter, we dug down into the nature of the six stories as composed of tales of court contest and tales of court conflict. We also explored the nature of the apocalyptic visions, particularly as they differed from prophetic revelation. We noticed, too, that the book of Daniel, like Ezra, was written in two languages, Hebrew and Aramaic, so that the languages linked the two halves of the book. The linkage between the two halves was also observed in the chiasm that is formed in chapters 2 through 7. Discussion questions. 1. What makes the first six chapters of Daniel different than the last six? 2. What links the two halves of the book, Daniel chapters 1 through 6 and chapters 7 through 12, together? 3. What is a chiasm, and where do you find a chiasm? 4. Where do you find a chiasm in the book of Daniel? What function does it serve in the book? 2. Babylonian exile and Persian and Greek domination. The historical setting of the book of Daniel. The Bible was not written to us. That statement may sound shocking at first, so let me quickly say that while the Bible was not written to us, it was certainly written for us. But Bible readers in the 21st century AD need to understand and take into account that the book was written in antiquity and in a particular culture, Israelite, to a contemporary audience who had their own particular questions and concerns. In order to rightly apply the book to our lives, we have to know something about the time period in which it was written and the people for whom it was written. We need to know both the historical context that lies behind the book and the particular historical context of the first audience. As we will hear, the first topic is uncontroversial but important, while the second is very controversial but less important for understanding the effect of the book. Daniel's time and place in history. We will first go over the historical background presented by the book itself for the six court tales and the four apocalyptic visions. The plot of the book begins squarely in the Neo-Babylonian period and extends through the early Persian period. The book begins, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it." Daniel chapter 1, verse 1. The third year of Jehoiakim would be sometime around 606 to 605 B.C. All the first readers of the book of Daniel would know the backstory. Readers today know the story from the biblical histories as well as from ancient Near Eastern sources that have been discovered over the past century and a half from archaeological sites in the area that was ancient Babylon, modern-day Iraq, particularly the southern part. The last chronological reference in the book while Daniel is still alive is found in the first verse of Daniel chapter 10. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia. The third year of Cyrus was approximately 536 B.C. Thus, the events of the life of Daniel covered by the book extends from 606 to 605 B.C. to 536 B.C. We will go over what we know about this time period next, but before we do, let's review the history that leads up to this moment in time. The deep background to the story of Daniel. The Bible contains one grand narrative of God's care for His human creatures. We come to a richer understanding of any portion of that narrative by understanding its place in the whole. Thus, we begin our study of the background of the book of Daniel by giving a brief reminder of where we are in the biblical narrative when we start the book of Daniel. To root Daniel's story in the deep past of the Bible, we begin with the account of creation. According to Genesis chapters 1 and 2, God created everything, including human beings. At that time, humans were given the status of divine image bearers. They were innocent and capable of moral choice. Genesis chapter 3 tells the story of how humans used their moral choice to assert their own independence rather than to follow the guidance of God. Thus, as Paul later says, for the first time, sin and death became a part of human experience. Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21. God judges the sin of Adam and Eve, but He still extends His grace to them, symbolized by Him giving them clothing. Their sin led to alienation from God, so they no longer lived in His presence, but had to build special holy places, altars, and offer sacrifices to draw close to Him. That sin separated humans from their holy God is not surprising. What is amazing is that God does not give up on His human creatures, but rather pursues reconciliation with them. Genesis chapters 3 through 11 presents four stories: Adam and Eve's rebellion, Genesis chapter 3, Cain killing Abel, Genesis chapter 4 verses 1 through 16, the flood, Genesis chapters 6 through 9, and the Tower of Babel, Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. The first three stories have the same literary pattern: human sin, God's judgment speech, a token of grace, and the execution of God's judgment, that demonstrates persistent human sinfulness, God's determination to judge sin, and also His continuing grace to them. The Tower of Babel presents a slight but significant departure from the four-part pattern of the other stories in Genesis chapters 3 through 11. A close look at Genesis chapter 11 verses 1 through 9 shows that there is no token of grace in this story. The best explanation for the omission is that the Tower of Babel's token of grace is not in the story itself, but found in the call of the patriarch Abram. "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse." and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Elsewhere, I go into detail on this rich and pivotal passage. Here we must content ourselves by pointing out that this call to Abram, soon renamed Abraham, is God's strategy for reaching reconciliation with his sinful people. Abraham's special status, his election, and that of his descendants, Israel, was not for his or their own privilege, but rather for the service of the whole world. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you, a service that would lead to suffering. The book continues by describing the period of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Genesis chapters 12 through 36, whose colorful stories show the passing down of the promise from father to son. The last portion of the book, Genesis chapters 37 through 50, presents an account that focuses on Jacob's 12 sons, who will become the father figures of the later tribes of Israel, Jacob's second name, Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 through 32. And their actions in this story will affect those tribes' later roles. See Genesis chapter 49. At the end of the book of Genesis, Jacob's family has sought refuge in Egypt because of a devastating famine. The final note indicates an awareness of an ultimate return to the promised land. Genesis chapter 50, verses 24 through 26. The book of Exodus begins some centuries later. The people of God are no longer an extended family, but now a bustling population. They are, however, also serving as slaves to the Egyptians. God, though, heard the cry of the enslaved Israelites and sent Moses to lead his people out of Egypt and to the Promised Land. The Israelites were no longer servants of the Pharaoh. They were now servants of their God, who was responding to their cries for help because of his promise to Abraham to make them a great nation. Genesis chapter 12, verse 2. Their entry into the Promised Land, though, was delayed due to their persistent complaints in the wilderness. Thus, the generation that left Egypt was condemned to die in the wilderness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.